again politically. If politically, the men and women should support each other. Islam gives women the right to vote. If you read Surah Al-Mumtahina, chapter number 60, verse number 12, it says that, O Prophet, when the believing women come to thee with an oath of fealty, here the Arabic word is bayan. And bayan means much more than our modern present day election. Because Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he was not only the messenger of Allah, but he was also the head of the state. And women came to the Prophet and they agreed with him being the head of the state. So Islam gives the woman even the right to vote. Women can even take part in lawmaking. And according to the famous hadith, in which Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was discussing with the Sahabas and considering putting an upper limit on the mahar, since young men were being discouraged from getting married. A lady from the back seat, she objected and said, when the Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 20, that you can even give a heap of treasure, a heap of gold in mahar, when Quran puts no limit on mahar, who is Umar to put a limit? May Allah be pleased with him. And immediately, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, Umar is wrong and the lady is right. Imagine, she was a common lady. If it had been a famous lady, the name of the lady would have been mentioned in the hadith. Since the hadith does not mention the name of the lady, we can understand that the lady was a common lady. Means even a common lady can object to the Khalifa, the head of the state. And in technical terms, it will be called that she's objecting to the breach of the constitution, because Quran is the constitution of the Muslims. That means a woman can even take part in lawmaking. Women have even taken part in the battlefields. There's a full chapter in the Sahih Bukhari mentioning women in the battlefield. Women gave water, they gave first aid to the soldiers, and there is a particular mention of a woman by the name of Nasiba, who were among the few who protected our beloved Prophet during the Battle of Uhud. Because the Quran says, man is the protector of the woman. Under normal circumstances, the woman should not go to the battlefield. It's the duty of the man, only when required. Under necessity, are the women allowed and they should go to the battlefield. Otherwise, no. Otherwise, you'll have the same position as you're having in the USA. There, women were allowed to join the battle since 1901, but they were not allowed to take active part. They only played the part of a nurse. Later on, after the feminist movement just had started, in 1973, the feminist movement demanded, why aren't women allowed to take active part in the battlefield? So the American government allowed, after 1976, women were allowed to take active part in the battlefield. And last year, according to a report of the Defense Department, of America, which was released on the 23rd of April, 1993, it said that 90 people were sexually assaulted in a convention, out of which 83 were women, and 117 officers were charged with indisciplinary action. Imagine, in one convention only, 83 women sexually assaulted. What was the crime of those 117 officers? They made the women run and they snatched at the clothes. They made them parade absolutely nude without even covering the genital parts. They were made to have sex in public. Is this what you call women's rights? If you think that this is what a woman's right, then you can keep your rights to yourself. We don't want our sisters, our daughters, our mothers to be sexually assaulted. And there was an uproar in the parliament, and the president, Bill Clinton, he himself had to apologize, publicly apologize, and he said, necessary action will be taken. And you know, when politicians say necessary action will be taken, what happens? So Islam allows women to take part in the battlefield only when required. But there also they should maintain the Islamic hijab and the Islamic ethics and the modesty. Before I conclude my talk, I'd like to give an example. As I said in the beginning of my talk, Islam believes in equality between men and women. Equality does not mean identicality. Suppose in a classroom, two students, student A and B, during an examination, both come out first. Both secure 80% marks, 80 out of 100. Out of the hundreds of students, two come out first, A and B. When you analyze the question paper has 10 different questions, each carrying 10 marks. In question one, student A got 9 out of 10, and student B got 7 out of 10. So in question one, student A was higher than student B. In question two, student A got 7 out of 10, and student B got 9 out of 10. Student B was higher than student A in question number two. In question three, both of them got 8 out of 10, both were equal. When you add up the marks of all the 10 questions, both student A and B got 80 out of 100. So in short, student A and student B are overall equal. In some question, A is higher than B. In some question, B is higher than A. In others, both are equal. In the same fashion, taking the example that since Allah has given man more strength, suppose a thief enters the house. Will you tell, I believe in women's rights? I believe in women's rights. Will you tell your mother, your sister, and your daughter to go and fight the thief? No, but naturally you'll fight him. If required, they may interfere. Under normal circumstances, since Allah has given you more physical strength, you have to go and tackle the thief. So here, in physical strength, man is 1 degree higher than the woman. Let's take another example. When it comes to respecting the parents, the children are supposed to respect the mother 3 times more than the father. Here, the women have 1 degree higher than the men. Overall, both are equal. So Islam believes in equality, not identicality. Men and women are overall equal in Islam. This was in brief, not in detail, as Justice Qazi said. Time does not permit me to speak in detail. This was in brief, the highlights of the women's rights in Islam. After this, what the Muslim society did is different. Many of the Muslim societies did not give the women their rights, and they deviated away from the Quran and the Sunnah. The Western society is largely responsible for this. Because of the Western societies, many Muslim societies have become overprotective, overprecautious, and have gone to one extreme and deviated away from the Quran and the Sunnah. On the other extreme, some of the Muslim societies agreed with the Western culture and followed their culture. I want to tell the Western society that if you analyze the women's rights in Islam according to the Quran and the Sunnah, you will realize it's modernizing and not outdated. Lastly, I would like to thank those people who have helped and supported me. If there is any one person who requires credit for me being here, it's my